Together, we are brilliant. I hope our brilliant participants are doing fine today and are ready to go ahead with the fifth day of FGD. Today, I am profusely elated to introduce our resource person for today's session, Dr. Amitabh Pandey sir, Associate Professor, School of Management Sciences, Varanasi. He's going to address us about Criterion 5, Student Support and Progression. Dr. Amitabh Pandey is a veteran management professor, experienced professional with a demonstrated history of working in academic administration and sales. He is also the coordinator of postgraduate diploma in management program here at SMS Varanasi. Having completed Bachelor of Science in Statistics Honours from Faculty of Science, Banaras Hindu University, and MBA with Marketing Specialization from FMS BHA, Dr. Pandey also possesses more than 3 years of corporate experience. For more than 16 years, Dr. Amitabh Pandey has been taking diverse courses in marketing, sales management, integrated marketing communications, rural marketing, marketing research, consumer behavior, international marketing, business statistics, and operations research for students of commerce, computer application, and business management programs. A PhD from IFTM University, Moradabad, Dr. Pandey's research interest lies in the area of corporate image management. He has collaborated actively with researchers in the field of spirituality, leadership, retail management, international business, banking services, and organizational development. With extensive experience in organizing conferences, workshops, and faculty development programs, Dr. Pandey has contributed several book chapters and has published numerous research papers in national and international journals of research. Dr. Amitabh Pandey is actively discharging different academic and administrative responsibilities at SMS Varanasi, like convener of Alumni Association, coordinator of internal communication cell. He is also a member of AQIC, is consulting editor of Management Insight, the member of Training and Placement cell, coordinator of Social Media Marketing cell, and faculty development program, and also the center superintendent of UG and PG examinations. Being an innovative and expert professional, Dr. Amitabh Pandey has regularly been invited as a resource person at various celebrated forums like Technology Business Incubator, Institute of Technology, Banaras Hindu University, Malviya Center for Innovation, Incubation, and Entrepreneurship, BHE, Department of Electronics Engineering, KNIT, Sultanpur, Kashi Institute of Technology, Varanasi, Department of Sociology, a Center of Excellence, Mahatma Gandhi Kashi Vidyapeeth, and several other Government of India supported programs. Very positively, I can say that everyone present here is much keen and excited to listen to your deliberations, sir. So humbly, I request you, sir, to please take over the session from here. Please, sir, over to you.
Thank you very much, Namika ma'am, for this elaborated introduction. I'm humbled with your words, and I extend my heartfelt welcome to all the participants, and a very good morning to everyone present here. So today we are in the fifth day of the faculty development program on quality assurance in higher education institutions, revised NAC framework. And in the last 4 days, we have gone through the different criteria of the accreditation process. We started with the process and preparedness. Then we looked at the criteria 1. Then we looked at the criteria 2, criteria 3, criteria 4. And finally, we are here at the criteria 5. So before I begin, like my previous speakers, I would also like to put this disclaimer that whatever information I'm going to share, all this information has been taken from the manuals of NAC. They are not my own findings or not my own prescriptions. These all have been prescribed and given in the manual of NAC accreditation for different types of institutions. So I will start my presentation Is my screen visible? Anamika, if you can tell me.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So like I said, I'll be, give me a second. I'll be focusing on the criteria 5, which is about the student support and progression. We know that student happen to be the most important stakeholder of any higher education institution. They are the purpose of the existence of higher education institution. Without the students, the higher education institution cannot even be there. So whatever we do to make their journey meaningful, and to we our prime job, prime objective as a higher education institution is to support these students in their journey where they are staying at the higher education institutions, and also when they are progressing for their further career or their further studies. This journey, this has to be made meaningful, this has to be supported, and we have to take all the care in providing all the assistance and all the facilities to the students during their stay with the higher education institution. And that is why probably the NAAC has included this criteria in their accreditation and assessment process. And I'm reminded of what Professor Pratosh Bansal said yesterday, that as a peer group member, he shared his experience that the peer team members, they focus on two things. One is the intention and the other is the perception. So this assessment is based on the intention, is also based on the intention of the higher education institutions, and also the perception which they form. And basically, if the intentions are right, the perceptions will also be better. So here, the NAAC wants the higher education institutions to focus on certain facilities, mechanism, which makes the journey smooth for the students, and also which makes the progression to higher education and meaningful employment more smooth and seamless. So if we talk about the focus of this criteria 5, this criteria 5 basically wants to see the efforts of an institution, higher education institution, towards providing necessary assistance to the students. Also, it focuses on how the higher education institution is enabling the student to acquire meaningful experience for learning at the campus. And it also emphasizes on how the higher education institution facilitates the holistic development and progression of the students. Also, if the higher education institution is making all these efforts, if they are providing necessary assistance, if they are enabling the students to acquire meaningful experience for learning at the campus, and if they are facilitating the holistic development and progression of the students, then definitely it will result into better student performance and alumni profile. So the NAAC also is interested to see what is the performance of the students of higher education institution, and also how the alumni are performing, or what is the profile of the alumni. And they are also interested in the progression of the students to higher education and gainful employment. So the criteria 5 is basically highlighting on these factors. Now, if we talk about the key indicators of the criteria 5, the key indicators include, first one is student support, the second is student progression, then student participation in activities, and alumni engagement. I've told you this is all about the students and the alumni. Now, if we look at the criteria summary for different criteria, there are 7 criteria in the NAAC accreditation and assessment process. So all those criteria have a different distribution for the different types of institution. And if we look at the criteria 5, so we see that criteria 5 has actually 10% weightage for the universities, and it carries 10% weightage for the autonomous colleges, 14% weightage for affiliated UG colleges and 13% weightage for affiliated PG colleges. So we can say that it carries a significant weightage in the overall assessment process and overall score of the higher education institutions while they are going for accreditation. Now, further, if we talk about the criteria 5 specifically, then the different key indicators, what are their distribution and how this distribution is happening for different types of institution, like for universities, autonomous college, and affiliated and affiliated UG and PG colleges. So we can say that here we see in the university and autonomous college, the percentage is 30%. The first key indicator, student support, it carries 30% weightage for universities, 30% weightage for autonomous colleges. And in UG and PG college, we see that the weightage is slightly higher. In UG, it is affiliated colleges, it is 35.7%. And for PG affiliated colleges, it's 38.46%. So my purpose of showing this percentage weightage is that the institutions which are going for accreditation, depending on the type of institution they belong to, they may craft their strategy as to how they can focus on a particular key indicator in order to gain more score in the assessment process. So this can help them in formulating and crafting their strategy. Now, let us move to the first key indicator. The first key indicator is student support. This is 5.1, first key indicator, student support. And here in this key indicator, the NAC manual talks about the different facilitating mechanism which are being adopted by the higher education institutions, like the provision for guidance cell, placement cell, grievance retention cell, and welfare measures for the support of students. And also, they are interested in looking at the provisions made by the higher education institutions for capability enhancement in relevant areas. Also, they want that there should be a well-structured, organized guidance and counseling cell or system should be in place in the institution. And they also are interested that, and they want the institutions to capture or identify the students who are benefited through these support facilities and mechanism. And already I have told you the scores which are allocated for different types of institutions. So for UG it is 50, for PG it is 50, for autonomous college it is 30, and for universities it is 30. I'll be taking the different types of institutions one by one, and we will be looking at the SSR for different types of institutions. So starting from the, and there are certain differences in some of the places, and there are in some of the criterias, in some of the metrics, we will find that there is similarity and there are certain differences as well. So I'll be taking them as the differences or similarities come. So first, starting with the first key indicator, 5.1, which is about student support. If you look at the first matrix of the first key indicator, 5.1, and for the affiliated colleges, then we find that the first key indicator, first quantitative matrix or first matrix is a quantitative matrix, and the criteria question is about the average percentage of students benefited by scholarship and freeship provided by the government during last 5 years. So the affiliated colleges, they are required to provide the information about the average percent of students benefited by scholarships and freeships provided by the government during last 5 years. And for this, when you will be filling the SSR, you will be required to give the year-wise number of such students who are benefited by government scholarships and freeships. So here, the data requirement will be as per the data template. The name of the scheme has to be mentioned, and the number of students benefited through that scheme has to be mentioned. So as it is a QNM, that is a quantitative metric, so you have to get the value. Value means the number of students who are benefiting. And the formula for calculating the percentage will be first the year-wise calculation will be done, then the average for 5 years will be taken. But you need not bother about this calculation because you only need to enter the values in the SSR and the calculation will be done by the software itself and you will get the results. However, the formula is number of students benefited by scholarships and freeships by government divided by total number of students multiplied by 100. Now this total number of students, this the system will automatically take from your extended profile which you have created in the process of filling your SSR. So already this information is there with them. So this denominator part will be taken from there, fetched from there. And you just need to put the values in the given field and the calculation will be done by the system. So here the file descriptions which are to be uploaded, a self-assessed letter with the list of student sanctioned scholarship has to be uploaded. Any additional information will be required to be uploaded. An average percentage of students benefited by scholarships and freeships provided by government during the last 5 years, they have to be uploaded according to the data template, which I'll be showing you after this slide only. And then the second quantitative matrix, second matrix, which is again a quantitative matrix, is average percentage of students benefited the second quantitative matrix for the affiliated institution, which is again a quantitative matrix, is about the average percentage of students benefited by scholarship, freeship, etc., provided by the institution, non-government agencies during the last 5 years. So the first matrix was about the scholarship offered by the government. And the second matrix is about the scholarships and freeships offered by the institution and non-government agencies. And here, again, you'll be required to give the numbers in the prescribed format and the calculation will be done according to this formula. You need not bother about the formula. The formula, the calculation will be done by the system. And the total number of students, again, will be fetched from the extended profile information. The file description, which you need to include, upload, the number of the students benefited by scholarships and freeships, institutions, non-government agencies in the last 5 years, according to data template, this information has to be uploaded. So this is the data template, how it looks like. The data template is a combined data template for affiliated UG and PG colleges. So both the data related to quantitative metrics 5.1.1 and 5.1.2 need to be submitted in a single data template. It asks for these information. First, the average percentage of these students benefited by scholarship and freeship provided by government during the last 5 years. Average percentage of students benefited by scholarship, freeship, etc., provided by institution besides government during last 5 years. So you have to give the years, name of the scheme in which these students have got the benefit of scholarship and freeship, and the number of students benefited by government and scheme and amount has to be given here. And then the number of students benefited by institutions and institutions and non-government schemes has to be provided here. And you have to provide the link to relevant document. So if you have any extra information which exceeds 5 MB limit, then for that you have to provide the link. That information you can put on your website, higher education institutions website, and the link can be provided here. So we have to provide the number of students, values we have to put. We also have to give the value, amount of the scholarship received by the students, number of students and the amount. Here again, for government schemes as well as for private schemes, we have to provide the numbers and the amount. And also we have to provide the name of the scheme. So now the standard operating procedure related to 5.1.1 for affiliated UG and PG colleges. So here, as we know, in 5.1.1, we need to give the detail of the average percentage of students benefited by scholarships and freeships provided by government during last 5 years. So the documents required for verification by DVB will include sanction letter of scholarship, freeships, year-wise list of students benefited in each scheme. So the letter, sanction letter, has to be provided for verification, and also the year-wise list of students benefited in each scheme has to be provided. And here, since this scheme is only for the government scholarships, only government scholarship freeships, both state and central, has to be given. And if the data is large, the DV will ask for specific students' detail randomly. They may ask for detail of randomly selected students, and the higher education institutions will be required to provide that detail to the DVB. Then coming to the SOP related to 5.1.2, as this is related to the scholarship scheme of the institution as well as the non-government agencies, so the higher education institutions will be required to upload the policy document. Here, whatever scholarship or freeship the institution is offering, they should have a formal policy for award of those scholarships. So all the policy documents, like how this policy was formulated, the communication regarding that, if suppose a committee has been constituted, and so who constituted the committee, what notices have been issued for constitution of committee, how the initial meetings have taken place, those minutes of the meetings, and finally how that committee has come up with a policy, what policy they have come up with, and that policy need to be kept as a document and also has to be notified at the relevant places, at the website as well as notice board, so that students can access to the policy. They may be aware of the policy adopted by the higher education institution with regard to the scholarships and freeships. So that policy document need to be provided for verification. And year-wise list of students benefited, this list has to be kept as a document, as a record with the higher education institution, and copies of award of freeship scholarship along with the sponsoring agencies. If the higher education is offering these scholarships, so it has to be done formally with the help of a letter or some communication to the candidate. So those records of those communications, those letters, have to be kept as a document for verification. And if it happens to be a sponsoring agency, any other agency, non-government agency, then again the letter with regard to the issue of a scholarship and award of a scholarship has to be kept as a document for verification. Now, the other instructions for the higher education institutions, here already you have covered the freeships and scholarships offered by government in the first matrix. So here it will not include the earlier earlier mentioned documents or earlier mentioned details. Those details will not be again repeated here. So here only the HEIs have to consider scholarships and freeships sanctioned by the institutions and non-government agencies only. Government freeships and scholarships will not be included here. And here the audited statement showing the expenditure on scholarship, freeship, etc. have to be provided by the higher education institution. So if they have made a policy of offering the scholarships and freeships, so how much amount they have disbursed in that as per that policy, all that should reflect in their audited statement, account statement, which is duly audited. So this has to be kept as a record. And for large data, again, the DVB will ask for a specific number of the students in a specific schemes, and then we will have to accordingly provide the required data. Further, as I have already told, that the data given in metric 5.1.1 to be excluded here. So this In 5.1.2, we will not repeat the data which we have already given in 5.1.1. Now, in case of the autonomous colleges, we find that there are certain differences. So here, in case of autonomous, the weightage has changed. The weightage is 6 for 5.1.1, the metric, first metric, which is again a quantitative metric. And for 5.1.2, the weightage is 5. So here, the first quantitative metrics for autonomous is about the average percentage of students benefited by scholarships and free seats provided by the government during the last 5 years. So again, here it is about the government scholarships and free seats, both state and central. And the second is about the free ships and scholarships provided by the institutions and non-government agencies during the last 5 years. So it is similar to your affiliated institution. The data template also, again, it is a combined data template, and the information required is year-wise detail you have to give, the name of the schemes, number of students benefited by government scheme and amount, number of students, amount you have to mention, and number you have to put in here. The number of students benefited by institution's scheme and amount, number of students and amount, and the data related to 5.1.2 is also given here. Number of students benefited by non-government agencies. So number of students benefited by the government scheme, number of students benefited by the institution's scheme, and number of students benefited by the non-government agencies. All these numbers have to be given, the amount has to be given, and you have to provide the link to relevant document if the, like I have told you, what in SOP they have told that what different documents are required as a record, so has to be kept as a record, and what has to be produced. So those links can be provided here. So SOP of the autonomous colleges, the average percentage of students here, the sanction letter of scholarship has to be uploaded. Year-wise list of beneficiary students in each scheme. This is about the government schemes, and only government schemes, both state and central, has to be covered here. Then in 5.1.2, average percentage of students benefited by scholarship, free ships, etc., provided by the institution and non-government agencies are to be covered here. Here we have to again upload the policy document of the HEI. Year-wise list of students have to be given, and copies of award of free ships and scholarships have to be given here. And audited statement showing the expenditure on a scholarship, free ships from institutions, non-government agencies. And also if the data is large, the DV will ask for specific number of students in specific schemes, and that we have to provide. Now for university, it is a little bit different. First of all, the weightage is 10, and then here, the first quantitative metrics, 5.1.1, is about the average percentage of students benefited by scholarships and free ships provided by the institution, government, and non-government agencies during the last 5 years, other than the students receiving scholarships under the government schemes for reserve category. So, first of all, it is about all the types provided by the institutions, government, and non-government agencies. And also, we have to exclude the scholarships which have been, which comes under the government schemes for reserve category. So, reserve category scholarship schemes are to be excluded here. And if you look at the data template for university, again, they ask for the year-wise details, and name of the scheme has to be mentioned, and number of students benefiting in the under particular scheme, and the amount. So they have segregated it government scheme into three parts: government scheme, institutions scheme, and the scheme by non-government agencies. And in all these schemes, the number of students and the respective amount of the free ships or the scholarships has to be mentioned, and the links need to be provided. Again, if we talk about the standard operating procedure, so for universities, again, it is about the average percentage of students which are getting a scholarship all three types of scholarship, government scholarship, institutional scholarships, and non-government scholarships for during last 5 years, other than the students receiving scholarships under the government schemes for reserved categories. And the document required for verification includes policy documents for HEI for award of scholarship and freeships. It is about the institution's scholarship. When institution is offering some scholarship, they need to provide and upload the policy document. And then year-wise list of students benefited along with the name of contributing agencies scheme. I have shown it in the data template. All the different agencies, whether it is government, institution, or non-government agency. So agency-wise, the list of benefiting students along with the amount has to be mentioned year-wise. And consolidated document of scholarship, freeships, and number of beneficiaries in each year. A consolidated document is also required. First, we have given the breakup different agency-wise. Now, the consolidated year-wise detail needs to be furnished. And we again need to upload the sanction letters, scholarship, sanction letter for scholarship, freeships for each of these schemes. The specific instructions here, the scholarship, freeship sanctioned by institution, government, and non-government agencies, all three types of scholarships need to be considered here. And again, for last data, the DEVB will ask for randomly selected students in specific schemes during the DEVB clarification. And we need to furnish that information. Now, for university, 5.1.2, if we compare it with the others, like affiliated and autonomous, we find that this 5.1.2 is different in case of university. So again, it is a quantitative matrix, and this matrix talks about the average percentage of students benefited by career counseling and guidance for competitive examinations offered by the institutions during the last 5 years. So the higher education institutions are expected to provide for career counseling guidance and competitive examination guidance for students, for their students. So they need to provide this information here. Again, there is a template in which you will be required to give year-wise detail, number of students who are benefited through these schemes, and there is a formula for calculating the percentage. Again, you are not required to bother about these percentage. If you look at the data template, if you look at the data template of 5.1.2 for university, so the informations are to be provided year-wise. First, we will give the information regarding the competitive examinations, guidance for competitive examinations offered by the institutions during the last five years. So the list of the activities, name of the activities has to be given here, and number of students attended and participated. Here, the number of students benefited by the scheme means those who have attended and participated. So that is the number who are benefited. So you have to give the activities, whatever activities you have undertaken in under this guidance for competitive examination. So better practice is the higher education institutions, they should come up with a cell for guidance for competitive examinations, and that cell can undertake different activities, and those activities need to be mentioned while you are filling the SSR. And the number of students who have attended those activities and participated those activities, their details need to be provided here. So it's better that whenever you are organizing any activity under this cell, you keep a record of the participants who have attended. So for any particular program, you get the student registered, go for a registration of the candidate for a particular program. So you will be having the list of students who have registered, and then who have actually attended. You can capture their attendance on the day of that particular event. And this can be done using technology also. You can create an online form, Google form, through which you can seek the registration of these students. And attendance, of course, either you can take the attendance physically if you are like, in normal days, we can conduct these activities in the classroom. So there you can take the attendance of those registered students on a sheet, on a paper, or We can also take the feedback of the students, and that can be used as a proof for proof that those people have participated, and that feedback can be taken online also on the same day. So this can be done, and it will be easier for you to keep the record of such activities if you use technology and use Google Forms and Google Sheets for this purpose. Then coming to the another set of activity which are undertaken under the career counseling. Here again, the institution, higher education institution, can come up with a career counseling cell which provide counseling to the students with regard to their career doubts and career plans. So again, this cell will be expected to undertake different activities, different sessions, and again, they are required to provide the details of the students who have attended and participated in these sessions, these activities undertaken by the career counseling cell. So once again, here you need to keep the record of the people who have participated, and again, you can use the same methodology, go for online registration, go for online feedback, and that will be easier for the people who are managing these cells to maintain the data records for this particular activity. And since we have to produce all the records online only, so this will be much more easier than keeping the offline records of the different papers generated otherwise. Now, this in case of university, this also talks about the number of students placed through campus placement. So again, you need to provide the numbers of the students in different years who have got a placement offer through campus placement here, and the relevant links of relevant documents need to be provided here in the template. Now, the standard operating procedure for 5.1.2 for universities, as in this matrix, we need to provide the average percentage of students benefited by career counseling and guidance for competitive examination offered by the institutions during the last 5 years. The documents required for verification by DVB includes the copy of circular, brochure of such programs, along with the details of the resource person. So whenever this career counseling cell or the cell for guidance for competitive examination is undertaking any activity, they need to notify it through a circular or a notice, and they may also come up with a brochure of such programs, and that brochure should contain the details of the resource persons who will be involved in delivering these programs. And then again, year-wise list of students attending each of these schemes has to be provided for verification, and this should be signed by a competent authority. So the competent authority here can be the coordinator of the cell, the particular cell, the guidance cell or career counseling cell. The coordinator of that cell can be the competent authority who can attest it. And report of the program and photograph with date and caption. So we need to keep a proof of all the activities we have undertaken under these two cells. So report of the program, what all has been done and what has been the outcome, how many people have attended, when it was conducted, who was the resource person, all these details can be there in the report, and also the photograph of the event along with the caption can be kept as record, which will be which can be asked by the DVB. Then specific instructions to HEI. Here, student benefited refers to students enrolled attending these said programs. I just told you all that the students benefited means here the students who have enrolled and or who have attended the said program. The DVB can seek the documents regarding the attendance and certificate of the selected list of students enrolled. So we need to keep the attendance record, and also if we are offering any certificate, that we should have a track of the certificate issued. Maybe we can, like here again, I can suggest you can use technology and that can help you keep the record also. And this process is very, this will make the entire process very simple. There are such applications using which you can generate e-certificates, and which are very easy to generate and very easy to keep a track of what when the certificates have been received, and you can have a digital record of those certificates. So there are applications like Autocrat application can be added. This is an add-on in the Excel feature. You can further search about Autocrat, and that can be used for generating the e-certificate. And even the record can be kept very easily, and that can be reproduced in, and those records are always there in cloud, so you need not have access to a specific computer. You can access the information from anywhere, wherever you are. So technology makes our life more simple. Then moving ahead, the another matrix here, this applies to UG and PG, and there is a slight difference for university and autonomous. I have covered it all here. The 5.1.3, it talks about the capacity building and skill enhancement initiative taken by the institutions, and it includes the following types of capacity building and skill enhancement initiatives, like soft skills, language and communication skills, life skills, which includes yoga, physical fitness, health and hygiene, and ICT or computing skills. I'll show you in the next slides that the difference in case of ICT and university is about this ICT computing skills. Instead of ICT and computing skills, in the SSR, it mentions recent trends in technology. Recent trends in computer and technology. So it is more or less the same thing, ICT and computing skills, or recent trends or advancement in computer technology. They are almost the same thing. So this applies to all three types of institutions, UG, PG, affiliated, and autonomous, and university. And the capacity building or competency enhancement, the students, in order to lead a successful life, to build a successful career, and they do not only need the hard skills, but they also need the soft skills and life skills, because you see these days, and also the ICT skills. We are living in the internet age, and everything is facilitated by the technology. So if we lack these skills, ICT or computing skills, or if we don't know how to handle the how to handle our health, or how to manage the stress, and also if we are lacking in the interpersonal skills, in the time management skills, in we lack the leadership qualities, we are poor at written and verbal, non-verbal communication skills, presentation skills, public speaking skills, we will find it very difficult. The students will find it very difficult to prosper in their life or to move ahead in their professional career. So in order to equip them with these skills, this focus has been, the NAC has focused on these capacity building and skills enhancement initiative, which should be taken by the institution. And here it is again a QNM, means the quantitative matrix is there. So if the institution has, higher education institution has schemes or programs with regard to soft skill development, language and communication skill development, and life skill, yoga, physical fitness, health and hygiene skills development, ICT and computing skills development, then if any institution has all these four types of capacity enhancement program, capacity building program in their institution, they can opt for option A. And if only three applies to them, they can opt for option B. Similarly for two, if the higher education institution only provides two of these programs, then C is the option for them. Similarly D and E are the options available. So depending on how many such initiatives are undertaken by the institution, they may have to opt for A, B, C, D, or E. And then data requirements are there, which are according to the data template. So here, for the UG and PG colleges, they had to provide the name of the capability enhancement program. So here we can come up with different programs, workshops related to soft skills development, language and communication skill development, life skill development, and ICT and computing skill development. For example, for the undergraduate students, some courses on Excel or PowerPoint, on SPSS, for commerce students, courses on Tally. These can be the courses, some workshop can be organized on these topics. Soft skills like leadership development programs, like personality development program, like interpersonal skill development program, confidence building program, motivation skill, self-motivation building program, time management programs or workshops. Then yoga and physical fitness and health and hygiene related workshops can be organized. The students these days are they are very much fitness conscious, and they also enjoy these sessions. Physical fitness and yoga sessions and health and hygiene is particularly more important because these days we are running a very stressed life. So in order to overcome that stress of our life, we need these skills. Not only we, but the students also need such skills. So such workshops can be organized, and the details of such capability enhancement programs need to be furnished in the data template. Sorry. The date of the implementation of the program in the DDMM YYYY format has to be mentioned. Number of students enrolled. Again, I suggest whenever we organize any such workshop or program, we go for registration of the students either through a physical form, a printed form on a paper, or we can go for an online registration of the students. And here we have to provide the details of the agencies or consultants involved with contact details, if any. So you need to provide the name of the program which have been undertaken under these different initiatives. Sorry. And then date of those implementation of those schemes, number of students who have enrolled, and the agency along with their details, contact details. Data template for University and Autonomous, the same information need to be provided. Only difference was, I told you, this was about the ICT and computing skills, and there it was awareness about the trends in computer technology. Awareness of trends in technology, this was the difference. Awareness of trends in technology. All other things remain the same. So the standard operating procedure with regard to this key indicator 5.1 and the matrix 5.1.3, which is about the capacity building and skill enhancement initiative taken by the higher education institution, and which includes soft skills, language and communication skills, life skills, ICT and computation skills. The documents required for verification is web link to particular program scheme mentioned in the matrix. Whatever program you are mentioning, whatever workshop or program you have undertaken, you have implemented, you have organized, create a web link of that program. The report and other things of that program can be put on your website, and a web link of that need to be provided for DVB, to DVB for verification. Copy of circular, brochure, report of the event. This need to be preserved as a proof, as a record of the program which have been conducted under these initiatives. So copy of circular, notice, brochure, report of the event. Geotagged photograph with date and caption for each scheme or event. Now they have emphasized on geotag. This geotag, yesterday also Mr. Ram Gopal Gupta, he told us about how to create the geotag photograph. So you need a smartphone for that. Enable the location on, turn the location on your smartphone. Then take the photographs. Those photographs, when you save on the desktop, if you go to the property of that photograph, and in the detail, there is a subsection in the property details. If you go there, you will find that locational details, GPS details are given. Longitude and latitude of the location is given there. So this is how the geotag photographs can be created. And there is also a facility if suppose you have taken a photograph earlier and at that time you have not used the smartphone or the nowadays cameras also come up with this feature where you can turn the location on. They are GPS enabled cameras, digital cameras are there. So if you have not used any digital camera or you have not used the mobile phone and you have not turn the location on, you have simply taken a photograph and you now want to geotag it, then for that you can go to a website called geoimgr, www.geoimgr.com, and there it's a menu driven process. You can geotag your photograph by visiting this website. Go to that website and they have a very simple process of converting your photograph into a geotag photograph. Go through that process and you will get your photograph converted into a geotag photograph. Then a list of programs conducted and the number of students enrolled for each of the events. This list has to be provided for document verification to the DVB program, DVB partner. All the programs which have been conducted under these initiatives, the list of those programs and number of students enrolled for each of the events. So if you have done the registration, it will help you here. The specific instructions to HEI, consider all the students who have enrolled for the scheme. All the students who have enrolled for the scheme, enrolled means the registered students. Then DVB can seek the documents regarding the attendance and certificate for the selected list of programs, students enrolled to the specified program. So DVB can ask for attendance, keep the record of attendance. And also if you are giving certificates, keep the track of certificates. Suppose you are giving a physical certificate, then you can ask the students to put a signature once they receive the certificate. So list of attendees, when they are issued the certificate, they need to sign on the on a particular format. So you have a record that you have proved that you have issued a certificate. And certificates can also have the number, certificate number. Not to be included or considered, mere surplus and students list will not be accepted. If you just give the circulars and the students list and you do not have other details like the attendance and photograph and all other things, then it will not be accepted. You should avoid program conducted as part of the university curriculum. Anything which is part of the curriculum that will not form part of this initiative, capacity building and skill enhancement initiative. So that should be over and above the university prescribed curriculum. Moving further to the criteria, to the matrix 5.1.4, which is again a quantitative matrix, which talks about the average percentage of the students benefited by guidance for competitive examination and career counseling offered by the institution during the last 5 years. So we have seen, already we have covered it for university, and the criteria number is different in case of affiliated UG, PG and autonomous college. It was 5.1.2 for the university, and for affiliated UG, PG and autonomous college, it's 5.1.4. The distribution of marks is also different. For affiliated UG, PG, it is 10-10, and for autonomous, it is 6. The process is almost similar. Whatever we have done in the university, the same has to be done here. So this is the data template. Year-wise, name of the activities undertaken by the competitive examination and career counseling cell has to be mentioned. I have already covered it, so I'll skip this. This SOP, again the same thing is repeated. the copy of circular, brochure, report, along with the photograph, caption, date, year-wise list of students. Student benefited refers to students enrolled attending the said program. So it's the same SOP which was applicable to university. Only the matrix number has changed. So now moving to the 5.1.4, this 5.1.4, the numbering of this matrix is 5.1.4 for university, whereas for autonomous and affiliated college, this number is 5.1.5. So, but the content is the same. So here it talks about the implementation of guidelines of statutory regulatory bodies. This is about the redressal of student grievances, including sexual harassment and ragging cases. This is very important. There should be a proper mechanism for redressing the student's grievances, including sexual harassment and ragging. So what there are four criteria: implementation of guidelines of statutory regulatory bodies, organization-wide awareness and undertaking policy with zero tolerance, mechanism for submission of online, offline student grievances, timely redressal of grievances through appropriate committee. So if all these four are applicable to a higher education institution, then they should put value A in the SSR form. You need to just put the value. So if all four applies to you, you have to give A answer. And if it only three applies to you, B will be the answer. If two applies, C will be the answer. If only one applies, D, and like that. So this is to ensure that the organization has a proper mechanism for redressal of student grievances, all type of grievances, which can also include the sexual harassment and ragging. So there should be proper implementation of guidance of statutory and regulatory bodies. What is the mechanism you are following for implementing the guidelines of statutory and regulatory bodies? If you are creating awareness, how you are creating awareness, all these need to be one has to see if they are doing all these, then they can go for A. If only three are being done, B, and likewise. And the marks are for university 5, for autonomous it is 6, for affiliated it is 5. So the documents required for verification: minutes of the meetings of the student grievances as per the matrix. Whenever you receive a case, whenever a student reports their grievance, so what is the mechanism you are following for redressing that that grievance? And there should be a proper committee for handling the grievances, all different types of grievances. And that committee should, whenever they are sitting for addressing, redressal of the students' grievances, or when they are hearing the grievances of the students, they should always notify it. They should prepare minutes of the meetings, and the committee formation of the committee, the report of the committee, everything has to be notified, and also the web link of all these activities undertaken by the committee should be provided in the website of the higher education institution. And also there should be proof of constitutions of internal complaint, grievances committee, formation, sexual harassment committee, anti-sexual harassment committee, and anti-ragging committee as per the UGC regulation. So there should be, the higher education institutions are advised to create such committees and constitute such committees, and they should follow a proper procedure for constitution of these committees, and all those this entire process of constitution has to be documented, and the mechanism of the redressal should also go on record. That means whenever you are receiving a complaint, there should be a proper mechanism for receiving the complaint, then how that complaint will be redressed. There should be a proper mechanism, and this has to be notified to all the stakeholders so that they know how they have to proceed and how the committee functions. And the committee, whenever they are undertaking any case, they should put everything in black and white, means the reports, the minutes of the meeting have to be prepared for every sitting, every meeting. The minutes of the meeting, report of the grievance form from the concerned committee is essential. So without this record, without the record of the meeting, or without the report, without the minutes of the meeting, it will be as good as nothing has happened. It means you do not have any record of what you have done. So everything should be done in a formal manner. So this is very important. You should, if there might be institutions where they are reducing the grievances of the students, but they do not have a formal mechanism. So everything has to be in a formal manner. Organized structure should be there, and everything should be put in black and white. And this is the instruction for the higher education institution. They should keep the minutes of the meeting, report of the grievances, and it is essential for the verification. The mechanism of the redressions should be available as document and should be posted in the HEI's website. As I told you, what is the mechanism of redressal of the grievances? What a student has to do if he or she has any grievance, how they should approach to the particular committee, particular committee or cell, and how that committee functions, who are the concerned persons to whom they should be, the person who is having the grievance should contact, and how the committee works. All this information as a policy document should be available in the HEI's website. Now, moving to the second key indicator, that is student progression. Up till now, we have seen the student support part. Now, the student progression, the institution concern for students' progression to higher studies and or to employment. This is what the NAC emphasize on. How the intention part, what is the concern of the institution towards the student's progression to higher studies and to employment? So if NAC wants the institutions to identify the reasons for poor attainment and plan and implement remedial measures, sustainable good practices which effectively support the students, facilitate optimal progression. This is what is expected of the higher education institution, that they should have a mechanism where they are concerned, they are addressing the concern of the students' progression to higher studies and to employment. They are ensuring that students are making smooth progression to the higher education, higher studies, and also they are getting the meaningful employment. And sustainable good practices which effectively support the students, facilitate optimal progression. What are the good practices which the institutions are adopting? The institutional provisions facilitate vertical movement of students from one level of education to the next higher level or towards gainful employment. And students qualifying for state, national, international level examination or competition should be identified by HEI. So in this key indicator, this will be the focus, how the institution is making effort in making the progression of the students smooth to higher education and also to gainful employment. And also they need to identify the students who are qualifying for state, national, international level examination or competition. So this, the first part is about the effort, and second part is about the result, which need to be identified. We have to also measure the result. So if we provide for better progression to higher education and we care for their gainful employment, nationally they will be qualifying for state and national international examination or competitions. So once we have put the effort, the results will be reflected in their performance, and we need also need to measure the performance. So this breakup of the marks for UG it is 30, for PG it is 25, for autonomous it is 30, for university it is 40. So moving to the first matrix, which is again quantitative matrix. This the numbering of the matrix is a little bit different for university. For autonomous and affiliated UG PG college, the number matrix number is 5.2.1, and for university it is 5.2.2. The content of the matrix is same for all three types of institutions, and this talks about the average percentage of placement of outgoing students during the last 5 years. So here again you have to give the numbers year wise. Name of the data requirement are name of the employer with contact details, number of students placed, the formula is number of students qualifying or placed, and again percentage will be calculated using the formula. Let us look at the data template. So data template is like this. Year wise you have to provide the information, and then here they need the detail of the students placed with their contact details, name of the students and their contact details, the program graduated from UG or PG, from where they have graduated, that program detail need to be given here, name of the employer with contact details, you need to provide the employer contact details, pay package at appointment, pay package, what package the students got the employment, that package has to be mentioned here. So this is the data template, this information need to be furnished. Then looking at the SOP, for affiliated autonomous it is 5.2.1 and 5.2.2 for university. It is about average percentage of placement of outgoing student during the last 5 years. So the document required for verification by DVV includes the list of the students placed along with placement details such as name of the company, compensation and compensation details, etc. year wise. So already we have seen in the data template that we need to provide the list of the students along with their contact details, list of the company in which they are placed, the contact detail of the company, and also the package, the compensation. And this information need to be provided year wise. Then specific instruction to the higher education institutions. The placement through HEI placement drive and through pool campus interviews, recruitment drives at other colleges can also be considered. So here you can also include the pool campus drives or off campus placement drives can also be included. Information of those placement can also be included here. Again, if the data is large, DVV partner will ask for the appointment orders of the selected students. So if the data becomes large, they will ask for a sample or a specific student, selected students, and we need to provide that. Multiple offers to the same student to be counted once. Here it is to be noted that if a particular student gets multiple offers, so you need to count it only as one. If suppose a student got 5 offers, so it will not be counted as 5 placements. It will be counted as a single placement only. And not to be included or considered, if same student has multiple offers, it has to be counted only once, the same thing which is mentioned here. So multiple offers will be counted as one only. Moving to the next matrix, which is again 5.2.1 in case of university and 5.2.3 in case of affiliated UG, PG and autonomous college. So numbers are different for university and affiliated. The matrix number is different for university, affiliated UG, PG and autonomous college. So this matrix is again a quantitative matrix, and it is about the average percentage of students qualifying in state, national, international level examinations during the last 5 years. So here you need to provide the information at two level. First, at first level, you need to provide the information of the students who have qualified in any of or any of these examinations or similar examinations. similar examinations if they have qualified. So number of qualified students year wise has to be given here. And since this data is not there in the extended profile data, you need to fill it here. So here you have to give the number of students appearing for different examinations. It will form the denominator. Otherwise, in other cases, we have seen the denominator was already, the information about the denominator was already there in the extended profile. But since this, the organization does not know about the their students, that how many of them will apply for which. So this need to be provided here in a separate table. So you need to provide the number of students who have qualified for any particular examination, the examinations covered here, along apart from this, other similar examination can also be included, which are of the same level, national or state level examinations. They need to be, they can be included here. And then you also need to provide the number of students who have appeared for this student these type of examination. Then the percentage can be calculated. And again, you do not have to do the calculations manually. You have to just put the values, number of students qualified and number of students appeared. Now this is, let me tell you that this is not so easy to capture the details of the students who are appearing in a particular examination, competitive examination or any job related examination, state or national level job related examination. So here either the course coordinators or somebody has to take the initiative, and that person should be in continuous touch with the students, and the student should be made aware that whenever they apply for such examination, they need to inform the institute also. And this is easier said than done. This is a difficult task, but still one can find a way, and involvement will be very high. A person who is there to collect all these information, he had to get involved with the students deeply so that he can get the timely information. And this is not very easy task, because once the student complete their education, they are difficult to track, and also it's very difficult to get the information about the individual students who are appearing in any examination or who have cleared any examination. So unless you are involved deeply with those students, you are in continuous touch, you are taking pain to collect those information, it becomes difficult. But again, technology can again come to our help. We can use Google Forms, which can be shared with the students, and they can fill the details in those Google Forms. And also I will suggest that we can create groups of the students. Specifically, WhatsApp groups are not very useful here. We can create Facebook groups of these students. One particular batch of students, we create a separate Facebook page. That Facebook page or Facebook group, that will be a permanent group. WhatsApp groups are not permanent, but this Facebook group will be a permanent closed group, and where whenever you want to contact them, you can just put the form there and the students can fill there. So you can keep in touch with the students using the social media platforms, and you can use the Google Forms for collecting the informations. And the form collected to Google, the information collected to the Google form will be stored in a Google Sheet, which is attached to that Google form. And this Google Sheet can be shared by different people in the organization. Suppose if we take an example of an institution where they are running several UG courses, suppose they have BBA, BCom, BCA. So all the forms, the data captured to all the forms will be stored in a Google Sheet, which will have separate individual sheets for different courses, and this can be shared among the coordinators. of those programs. So they can have the access to the information in real time, and they can edit it from anywhere they like. And since it is on cloud, so they can work from anywhere. They need not to be dependent on a particular system. So this can make the process more easy. Even we can include the students for this process. Some of the students can also be the data can be collaborated. We can collaborate with them, and we can share the real-time data with them, and they can be asked to contribute by editing the data on their part. Not all the students can be involved, but some of the students can definitely be involved in this. Then moving to the next, that is SOP for this 5.2.3 and 5.2.1. Here they need the list of students qualified year-wise under each head, and qualifying certificate of the students taking the examination year-wise under each category. I told you this is not very easy task to get hold of these informations very easily. They need the certificate, qualifying certificate. So you need the detail of the students, name of the students, his roll number, the examination he has appeared, and also when he has qualified that examination, his certificate, his score, all the information. So you should have a record of all those information. So this record is needed. In absence of certificate, the claim will not be considered. So only if you write that name of the student and he or she has cleared a particular examination, this will not be considered. You need to provide the qualifying certificate. And exams conducted for job recruitments other than the examination conducted by state government not to be included or considered. See, the job recruitments which are conducted by state and central government will be included, but other job other exams conducted by job for job recruitment, like a company visiting for campus placement, if it is taking the aptitude test or any examination, written examination it is taking, that will not be considered here. Only the state and central government level recruitment examinations will be part of this data. Then moving to the next quantitative metrics, 5.2.2. Again, here we can see there is a difference in the numbering. For the university, it is 5.2.3, and for autonomous and affiliated UGPG, it is 5.2.2. And this is the breakup of the score. For university, it is 15. For autonomous, it is 15. For affiliated UGPG, it is 15. So it talks about the percentage of students progression to higher education previous graduating batch. So the previous graduating batch, how they have moved from UG to PG, PG to MPhil, PG to PhD, MPhil to PhD, PhD to postdoctoral. Again, the formula is number of outgoing students progressing to higher education divided by total number of final year students multiplied by 100. So you need information of all the students who are progressing to the next level, either from UG to PG, PG to MPhil, PG to PhD, MPhil to PhD, PhD to postdoctoral. The data template for the same is you need the name of the students enrolling into higher education. Any student, suppose a student has completed BBA and he has enrolled in MBA. So name of that student, program graduated from, so here you will write BBA, he has graduated from BBA. Name of the institution joined, the new institution from where he is pursuing the higher studies, the name of that institution will come here. Name of program admitted to. So suppose he has taken admission to MBA, so the name of program will be written here. So again, this is again a very difficult task. Once these students are out of the campus, it's very difficult to find out or track where they have taken admission. But again, if you use technology, this can be made simple. And again, you have to take a lot of pain in collecting this data. So this is not very easy task. Then moving to the SOP for this particular matrix, upload supporting data for students who have joined for higher education in prescribed format for all the years in the assessment period. What supporting data they need? Proof like admission letters or identity cards for higher degree certificates for selected students progressing to higher education will be asked by DVB partner. So you provide the data, but you have to keep all these ready, because the DVB partner can ask for admission letters, identity card, or higher degree certificate for selected students. And appearing passing competitive examination for higher education cannot be considered as progression to higher education unless students get admitted. So if you only have the information that the particular students have cleared any entrance examination or competitive examination, that does not mean that he has progressed to the next level unless he takes admission somewhere and you have the details of his admission, like proof of admission letter, you know where he has taken admission, in which course he has taken admission, all that is required. Now, moving to the next key indicator, 5.3, which is student participation and activities. Here it is about promoting the inclusive practices for social justice and better stakeholder relationships, and about promoting value-based education for inculcating social responsibility and good citizenry among its student community. And also, if this institution has required infrastructure and promotes active participation of the students in social, cultural, and leisure activities, and encouraging students' participation in activities facilitates developing various skills and competencies and foster holistic development. And NAC believes that if we encourage students to participate in activities, which in all these different types of activities where they are involved, they are included, they are made part of different activities of the institution where they have a say, and also they realize their social responsibility, and they know their duties as a good citizen and as a good community member. So, and also when we promote cultural, social, and sports activities, so they develop different types of skills and competencies, which helps fostering the holistic development of the students. Again, the breakup of the marks 50, 45, 30, and 20 for UG, PG, autonomous, and universities. So the first matrix 5.3.1 under the key indicator 5.3 is a quantitative matrix, and it talks about the number of awards, medals for outstanding performance in sports, cultural activities at inter-university, state, national, international event. Award for a team event should be counted as one during the last 5 years. So you need to provide the number of award, medals for outstanding performance in sports and cultural activities at inter-university, state, national, international events. And here, the award for team event will be counted as one. So you need to give the year-wise numbers. And this is the same for all different types of institution. Criteria number is same. This matrix number is same. Let us see the data template. So year-wise, name of the award and medal, team, and whether it was team and individual. So, and level, whether it was inter-university, state, national, or international, name of the event, and name of the students. So the higher education institution need to provide the details in this format: year, name of the award, medal, whether the event was team or individual, whether it was inter-university, state, national, international, name of the event, name of the student. SOP for the same: e-copies of award letters and certificate. Whatever award and certificate students have got by participating in the different activities at inter-university, state, or national or international level, so e-copies of those award and certificate should be kept as a record. And only inter-university, state, national, or international achievement will be considered. Inter-university, state, national, or international achievement will be considered for this purpose. And participants in Republic Day Parade at Rajpath, New Delhi by NCC candidates may also be considered. Award for a team event should be counted as one. Now, participation appreciation certificate and rewards from regional, local, institutional level should be avoided. In this particular matrix, we should not use the participation certificates or appreciation certificates or awards from regional, local, institutional levels. Awards from intra or inter-institute will not be considered. So this is only about the inter-university, state, national or international. No inter or intra-institute award, certificate, or even the regional, local, institutional level award and certificates has to be avoided here. Now moving to the next quantitative metrics, 5.3.2, which is about the presence of student council and its activities. It is about the involvement of the students in the affairs of the institution. So in universities and autonomous colleges, there could be student council, whereas in affiliated colleges, there may not be a student council the guidelines are a little bit different for three types of institutions. So let us see what the guidelines are. The presence of student council and its activities for institutional development and student welfare in case of university, the weightage is 5 only. So here one need to describe the student council and its activities for institutional development and student welfare. This is a qualitative matrix and you need to give the answer in 500 words. So file description, paste link for additional information, upload any additional information. So how the student council, whether there is a student council and what are the activities this council undertakes for institution development and student welfare, details of those activities need to be furnished here. And with regard to the affiliated colleges, the marks are 10 marks. And here, institution facilitates students' representation and engagement in various administrative, co-curricular and extracurricular activities. Student council, student representation on various bodies are established processes and norms. So either the affiliated colleges can have a student council or they can include the students in different committees and bodies of the institute as a student representative. So like they can be made representative of the library committee, of the anti-sexual redressal committee, or anti-ragging committee, or disciplinary committee, or they can be part of different clubs in the organization. So if there are different administrative bodies, the students or training and placement cell, so they can be given a representation there. These students can be made, student representatives can be included in the committees, different committees. So the practice has to be, this is a qualitative matrix. So whatever practice is adopted by the organization, that has to be given within 500 words as an answer to this qualitative matrix. And in case of autonomous, here presence of an active student council and representation of students on academic and administrative bodies, committees of the institution. So details about the presence of active student council and the representation of students on academic and administrative bodies, committees of the institution, all that detail has to be provided in 500, maximum 500 words. So since it was a qualitative matrix, there are no data template attached to it. And moving to the next 5.3.3, quantitative matrix. Again, it is a quantitative matrix. So again, we see that for university and autonomous, they have the same matrix, and for affiliated, it seems to be a different matrix. For university and autonomous, the marks are 5 for university and autonomous, for 10 for autonomous. Number of sports and cultural events, competitions organized by the institution year-wise during the last 5 years. So earlier we had given the details of the awards and medals at university level, state level, international level. Now it is about the competitions organized by the institution per year. So universities and autonomous colleges, they need to provide the information year wise of the number of events, sports and cultural events, competitions organized by them in a particular year. So here, name of the activity, number of sports and cultural events, competitions organized by the institution during the last 5 years divided by 5. Here, file description includes report of the event, any additional information about the event, number of sports and cultural event competitions organized per year, data according to the data template. Then comes the 5.3.3 for affiliated colleges. Average number of sports and cultural events competitions in which students of the institution participated during last 5 years. Here it could be either organized by the institutions or other institution. It was here in case of University of Autonomous, it was only about the competitions and events organized by the institution. Whereas for affiliated, they have this liberty that it could be the programs, the events organized by the institution, as well as the programs organized by other institutions. So again, you need to give the numbers here, year-wise. Let us look at the data template. For University in Autonomous, date of the event or competition, name of the event or competition, date and name. In case of affiliated, date of the event, name of the event, and number name of the students participated. So the affiliated institutions, they are also required to give the name of the students who are participated and classify the data and provide year wise. This need to be classified event wise and year wise. SOP for 5.3.3 for University in Autonomous, report of the event along with photographs appropriately dated and captioned year wise. So you need to furnish a report, keep a report ready, and copy of circular brochure indicating such kind of activities. Whenever such event were planned, they were organized before that, there should be a notification and there could be a brochure which contains all the details of the program. List of students participated in different events year-wise. This need to be maintained. This information need to be maintained. This record need to be maintained. Again, we can ask for registration. We can get the student registered in different events, and that detail can be kept as a record. All activities conducted under an event will be counted as one event. In a particular event, if there are different activities, that will be counted as one event only. Only the events organized by the institution need to be considered. In case of University in Autonomous, the events organized by the institutions only will be covered here. Events cannot be split into activities. Any particular event cannot be split into activities. So SOP for affiliated colleges, here report of the event along with photographs appropriately dated. The same thing here is repeated here. Here only difference is all activities conducted under an event will be counted as one event, and yes, the competitions organized by the institution without the participation of their own students will not be considered here. This is one thing they have added here, that any competition which is organized by the institution without the participation of their students will not be considered here. Other things remain the same. And one more difference is there. Average number of sports and cultural events competition in which students of the institution participated during last 5 years, organized by the institution or other institution. Here in case of SOP, in case of University in Autonomous, it was organized by the institution only. And in case of affiliated, it could be organized by the institution or it could be organized by other institution. Then the fourth key indicator, which is about the alumni engagement. We know that alumni are a very strong support to the student, to the institution. They are a very important stakeholder of the institution. They are the flag bearers of the institution. They are the one who has spread the fragrance of whatever values and education or knowledge they have inculcated during their stay at the institute. They spread it not only within the country but also the around the globe. So they are very important stakeholders. So an active alumni association can contribute in academic matters, student support, as well as mobilization of resources, both financial and non-financial. The alumni play a very important role. They not only help in academic matter or student support, they also can help us help the HEI mobilize resources, both financial and non-financial. And we have seen in very good institutions, reputed institutions like IITs, IIMs, their alumni are doing a lot of support activities for their alma mater. And this is why NAC is also putting a lot of emphasis on alumni engagement. The institute nurtures the alumni. Here, it is expected that the institute nurtures the alumni association and the different chapters of alumni association to facilitate them to contribute significantly to the development of the institution through financial and non-financial means. So you need to engage your alumni also. You need to keep them in loop with the organization and motivate and mobilize them for further contributing towards the growth of the organization, either by contributing in academic matters or student support or through financial and non-financial means. So quantitative matrix 5.4.1, it is about the alumni association chapters registered and functional contribute significantly to the development of the institute through, this is a qualitative matrix. So you need to give a description of the different alumni associations or chapters which you have, which are registered and functional, and how that contributes to the development of the institution through financial and other support services during the last 5 years. So how the alumni has been supporting the institute, or what are their involvement with the institute, with the higher education institute, and how they are contributing in different areas like I have told you, academic matters, financially, non-financially, student support. So how the organization is engaging the alumni. So the qualitative description of that is required for last 5 years. And then 5.4.2, it is about the contribution, financial contribution. It is about the money, the amount contributed by the alumni during last 5 years. For different types of institution, the categories which they have divided is the limits of that category are different for different types of institution. For example, if we talk about the affiliated institution, the if the contribution is greater than or equal to 5 lakh, while filling the SSR, the institute had to opt A, and for 4 lakh to 5 lakh, they need to opt B. For 3 lakh to 4 lakh, they need to opt C. For 1 lakh to 3 lakh, they need to opt E. And for less than 1 lakh, they need to opt E. For autonomous institution, this limit has been increased to 15 lakhs for A category, for 10 to 15 lakhs for B category, for 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs for C category, for 2 lakhs to 5 lakhs D category, and less than 2 lakh for E category. And in case of university, this limit has further been increased to 100 lakhs for A category, 50 lakhs to 100 lakhs for B category, 20 lakhs to 50 lakhs for C category, and likewise. So it is about the contribution of alumni in last 5 years in INR, rupees. Then SOP, SOP for this, annual audited statements of accounts of HEI highlighting alumni contribution duly certified by chartered accountant. So when you are claiming that you are in a particular category A, B or C because your alumni has contributed a specific amount, so you need to verify it, or this has to be substantiated by the statements of account, audited statements of account, and that audit has to be undertaken certified by the chartered accountant. So you just cannot simply make a claim that your alumni has contributed a certain amount. You need to provide a proof of that through your verified, certified statements of account, annual account. audited annual account. And list of alumni with the amount contributed year-wise to the institution. You also need to furnish the list of alumnus and alumni with the amount they have contributed year-wise to the institution. Again, the instructions for which should not be considered or not applicable. Mere list indicating the contribution will not be considered. If you just give a list that alumni has contributed this much amount, that will not be considered. Amount contributed towards alumni association or any kind of in any kind to the HUI not to be included, considered. So anything in kind, suppose the alumni has donated some books, that will not be counted here. Only money donated or contributed by the alumni will be included here. So anything in kind will not be included. Also, amount contributed towards alumni association. Towards alumni association means, suppose they have a registered alumni association. And the amount contributed by the alumni is for the alumni association, for the funds of alumni association. Then again, it will not be considered. We only will consider, the NAC will only consider the amount which have been transferred to HEI by the alumni or by the alumni association or a group of alumni or a individual alumni. So that amount has to be given to the HEI, not to the alumni association. So this is a technicality one has to pay attention to. That amount should be transferred to HEI. Only that will be counted here. Other amounts or anything in kind will not be included. So this was all about the criteria 5, student support and progression. So with this, I come to the end of my presentation. Thank you very much. Over to you, Anamika ma'am. Yes, Shubhankar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such wonderful deliberation. We have got a lot of insightful and a lot of queries. So I would be starting the queries with the participant has asked. Starting with the Indrani Ghosh ma'am, she has said, he has asked, in our university, we had a lot of student activity. However, we did not take any attendance or signature. Can photograph be submitted as proof?
If I can understand, she is asking about the programs they undertake at their university and they have not taken the attendance record of, they have not kept the attendance record of those programs. Only they have the photographs. So, see, NAC is asking for, the DVV will ask for the attendance record also. So from now onwards, whenever you are conducting a program, make sure that you also keep the record of attendance. Only like they have mentioned in the SOP also that only the notice or attendees will not help. Photograph, yes, it is a proof. As you have not taken the attendance record, so you can still furnish that as a proof. But now onwards, you should keep the attendance record also. Better to get the participants enrolled through a registration process and then take their attendance during the sessions and also take the feedback. So this, and when you are giving the certificates, you also take their signature on the certificate, on a list where it confirms that they have been issued the certificate. So this can serve as a record.
He also asked one more question regarding the same question. But can you tell us some few applications to generate e-certificates?
One of the application is AutoCrat, like I have told during my presentation also. This is an add-on feature. If you are using Google Sheet, see, similar to Excel, there is an application which is provided by Google. Now here I would like to tell one more thing. The higher education institutions, they should go for the Google Enterprise Suite. This is an application which is free for the higher education institutions or educational institutions. They provide it for free. So you switch your emails, institution emails to the Google Enterprise Suite, and there try to adapt all your, try to migrate from Excel to Google's spreadsheet, which is cloud-based application. And like I told you, this provides, this helps us share. We can work in a team using Google applications, and it is free of cost, and we can use, we can collaborate with many people in real time, and also we can use different add-ons. Like one of the add-ons is Autocrat. If you install that add-on to your Google spreadsheet, then using that, there are some very simple steps, and you can also see the procedure in YouTube, how to install at Autocrat and how to generate e-certificates using Autocrat, and that will make your life so easy. You just need this list of the participants, and you need to create certain fields in the template of the certificate, and it will be tagged with the different columns in the Excel sheet or Google sheet, and the application will fetch the data from there, and it will generate the auto the certificates automatically within the fraction of seconds. So this is very useful. For details, you can search in YouTube. There are many people have described how to use Autocrat, and it's very simple. Even if you find problem using it, then you can contact me. My email ID is there with everyone in the participant list, and my phone number is also there.
Yeah. Next question comes from two participants, Dinesh Kumar sir and Ritu Gupta, and it's very important questions. Most of the time, students receive government scholarship at the end of the session. How can the institute keep the record?
Can you come again with this question?
Most of the time, a student receives government scholarship at the end of the session. How can the institute keep the record? Because the students have already left the college.
Okay. I told you this is very difficult task to keep a track of the students. So still there are different ways in which we can keep a track of the students. When they come to, like one way is the different courses have their coordinators, and all the like I've told you, the coordinator can create a specific page on the Facebook. They can create a group, not page, but rather a group on the Facebook, where all the students can be asked to join that group, and we can remain in touch with the students through that group. Also, WhatsApp group can also be used for that purpose. Even Telegram group can also be used for that purpose, to remain in touch with these students even after they have written their examinations and they have moved to further in their life. And apart from that, whenever these students are coming back to collect their mark sheets, although many of them, they do not come even to collect their mark sheet, they come after 3 years or 4 years. So if suppose they are coming, then you can capture all before giving them the mark sheets, or before giving them the migration certificates or any kind of character certificates, you may ask them to provide all the details. You can create a template, a form where all the required information they need to write either in on a paper, or you can create a digital form also which they need to submit. And even and after submitting that information, only they will be issued the mark sheets or character certificates or migration certificate. So that can be done. And also we can find that there are some students who are the center of attraction of their batches. So those students, if we can catch hold of them, they can help us get connected with other students. So 3-4 such students can connect you to the whole class. So here, like I've told you, you have to get involved with the students, and you will have to take a lot of pain. Even you will have to call them to get the information. And if you are using the Google Sheet, it becomes easy because first you can ask them to fill the form. If suppose in the first go, many of them have not filled the form, then you know how many of them have not filled the form, and you can call them and you can yourself fill the data by asking them, and you can send the link to them for uploading the certificates and all other things through that form.
Next question also is asked by the Ritu Gupta ma'am. It is related to the student progression report. Does this record needed only for the previous year?
See, you have to give information for last 5 years. Whenever you are applying for accreditation, you need to give information for last 5 years. So you have to keep the track of the graduating students of last 5 years. So I think you need to keep the track of the progression of all the students in the previous year. Last 5 years student progression data need to be provided.
Palas sir has asked about the website which converts the simple photograph into geotag photograph.
It is GeoImgr, GeoImgr.
So Vasudha Sharma has asked that in today's time, we can see a lot of COVID quizzes around the country. So the students are participating in it. Are these considered for student participation and activities?
Come again?
Nowadays, many students are participating in COVID quizzes from different colleges around the country. Are these considered?
Considered for what?
I hope she is asking for student participant and activities for that. Third point.
No, under which head it will come? Like COVID related projects. It was about the cultural programs and sports.
Lots of quizzes are going around. So all the students around the country are just filling all the answers and getting the certificates. So I think ma'am wanted to ask that will this be considered under student participant and activity? Key indicator, third point.
Okay, so national level, regional level, and international level quizzes, if they can be considered as. Okay. Well, this is a new, which has emerged, online quizzes, and such NAC is silent about it. So they can give it a try. They can furnish this detail. DVV partner will take a decision whether to include it or not. They can take a chance and provide this information. Although NAC has not specifically told about the quizzes, online quizzes.
Chandra, and the last question for today's session is from Chandrasekhar sir. And he wants a small clarification that last year he was deputed to a different college. There he has organized various university games. Now he is back to the parent college. So while filling the details, can he mention what he has done in the other college in the present time?
Can you repeat the question?
Chandrasekhar sir has asked. Chandrasekhar sir has. Yeah. The last question. And he was deputed to a different college previous year. There he has organized various university games. This year now, he is back to his mother college. So while filling the detail, can he mention whatever he has done in the other college, in present college detail?
See, if he has organized any event in the previous college, in this criteria 5, we need to furnish the detail of the students who are participating in any activity or event, not the teachers. So a student, when he is in a particular college, as a student of that college, if he has participated in any activity or event, and he has won any award or any certificate has been given to him, those details need to be furnished to NAC under the criteria 5. So faculty members' data is not required.
So one last question. This question will be from my side, actually regarding alumni engagement. Can I proceed, sir?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Most of the time when alumni revisit their alma mater, they provide the many of the help in kind. Example, they will pay the money for renovation of the hostels. And they will not pay the money to the account of the alma mater, rather they pay by their own self. They will get all the material required and get renovated. Will this be included in the alumni contribution?
See, the SOP says the kind, anything in kind is not accepted, right? So it should be in amount, means the money has to be transferred.
Thank you. Now I would request Anamika ma'am to take over. Anamika ma'am, please.
Thank you.
I think she got disconnected. Are you there, Anamika? Anamika? I think she's not around. So should I proceed? Anamika? Finally, I'm asking you. Okay, I think she got disconnected. So Amitabh sir, thank you very much for dealing this student progression, this criteria 5, very meticulously. You have touched upon each and every point related to the university affiliated and autonomous. So once again, heartfelt thanks to you, and rest you can see the feedback of the participants. Okay, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. I think feedback form link
has been, yes, I had posted the feedback form. They have already submitted.
Thank you everyone. Thank you so much.
So let's call it a day now.
Thank you.
Have a good day.
Thank you everyone.
Mr. Vijay Yadav, we can close this meeting now.